It's not the stock market, because that the Fed doesn't buy the stock market, but the Fed buys mortgage bonds. So if they start to taper, watch that as well, and maybe get out of houses or real estate and go into gold. So that's another theme that's pushing higher right now, the gold price.
Let's just frame it a bit, though. We have had gold kind of come down after the spring. We did see it. It's now mid-November. It has sprung up on those CPI numbers. We're looking at about mid-1800s. What are you seeing on the finance side?
Yeah, gold has picked up, fortunately, but only in the last week, really, where we've seen a bit of a rally. But our Oreninc index has been rallying is maybe the wrong word, but has been going up and upticking the last 3-4 weeks. So it's been front-running a pop in gold price. And we've sort of seen and mentioned that as well in other conversations, that we've seen an opening of the financing window. So investors are willing to put money back into the gold companies right now. And they're not too afraid of taxless season, apparently, right now, because of the positive gold momentum.
Mm-hmm. Any types of companies that you see that are getting financings?
We've seen broad range of financings, being even copper as well, like this week as well, like our index that's coming out on Monday, it's going to be close to our benchmark level of 100. I've seen a 94 score this week, and I just got the numbers a few minutes ago here, and that's very, very high. And it's driven by one big financing, of course, is Nevada Copper raising $75 million through a bond deal led by Scotia. That has a big impact on our index score because we heavily weigh towards banking activity or banker and broker activity. But overall, we've seen 44 financings this past week. That's a high number. On average, over the summer or since the spring, we've been down more in the mid-20s. So that's almost a doubling of financing activity itself. And that's very positive to see.
Well, it also, if it's broad-based, I mean, that's also healthy as well, too. Because, I mean, you've noticed in the past when we've had this conversation that it's been skewed to people that are later down the stage.
No, exactly. So average deal size is about $4.8 million. Yes, we've seen now Nevada Copper this week. That's why I keep coming back to it with a $75 million deal. But a lot of other financings as well. Northwest Copper raising $20 million and others in that double-digit range. That's good to see. That means bigger tickets are being written. Institutions are more bullish as well, meaning they're betting on precious metals and commodities to rally coming forward. And maybe that infrastructure deal Biden has pushed through might have an impact there on the commodity or base metal space as well.
Explain tax loss season. What is it?
So tax loss season is when investors take money off the table and try to generate some negative returns on their books so they can offset some positive returns so they pay less taxes, right? But fortunately, we've seen now a run in gold price. So that might actually be mitigated. I personally was a proponent saying, oof, you know, tax loss season might have a negative impact on the already beaten down share prices. But no, the gold price is making up for that. We have some very, very positive momentum. We ended the week at 1865 up, which was really positive to see because the CPI numbers pushed gold higher. It seems like the general market seems to understand gold. We need to or diversify our portfolios just a little bit more, put money into a safe haven investment like gold. And that's pushing maybe the stock. Oh, it is pushing the stock prices higher as well as it trickles down right away.
Now, congratulations, because you timed this pop in gold to actually run a gold show. So I don't know how you do it, but I would be interested in hearing. But anyway, we're almost, we've almost rounded up your Deutsche Gold Messe show here in Frankfurt, Germany. Themes that have emerged, what have you been hearing people that have been saying?
So a couple of things. Bitcoin, of course, is a topic as well. Don't get me wrong. Like any sensible investor sort of looks at both gold and cryptos and maybe has both in their portfolio as well. So that's a theme we've been hearing. But also outflows from crypto into gold, because Bitcoin is the prominent one, obviously, but it's limited and gold is not. So meaning Bitcoin may pop and it's very, very volatile. Gold is more stable in that regard. So even in a volatile environment like we're in right now, there could be a black swan event any day. Gold probably is the better bet in that regard, although it seems to start to have the same implications on the monetary system. Like Bitcoin is not money yet because you can't use it at the bakery here. It's still cash. Like even some of the bakeries don't take credit card here in Germany, right? So we're still far behind the eight ball on that. But another theme, real estate bubble is another one we're tracking. I just listened to a keynote by Christian Vatian. He said, well, track what's happening on the mortgage side as well, because that's having a direct effect of money flows. It's not the stock market, because the Fed doesn't buy the stock market, but the Fed buys mortgage bonds. So if they start to taper, watch that as well, and maybe get out of houses or real estate and go into gold. So that's another theme that's pushing higher right now, the gold price.
My impressions when I've been talking to some of the headliners that we've had through here, like Ronny Stoffel, Wilhelm Mittelkoop, and then talking about I told you guys inflation was coming, you know, that seems to be, you know, and there seems to be really like, you know, there's a affirmation you would kind of say about this is what we were kind of concerned about. And then also, you know, having this hedge around gold seems to be people that have been really, how would you say, affirmed within their judgments on that?
Yes and no. Like inflation, and again, this morning, that's why it's fresh in my head. Christian Watson talked about just like, well, it's not real inflation. It is transitory. And he proved what Jerome Powell said. So a bit of a controversial opinion in our space, because, well, everybody's of the opinion, well, it's not transitory. It's based on factors like money supply, additional money printing. But if you look at it as well, it's like we might be actually more in a deflationary environment based on his thesis. It is the mortgage side, for example, that we have to watch. So if the Fed starts to like poison, or he called it poison the punch bowl at a party, or take the fun out of a party, then nobody will go to that party. They'll go somewhere else, like maybe the Japanese yen or something, because they're not tapering. Mm-hmm. So that taking that out, that's really, really interesting. One of the themes here.
What were some of the themes that emerged over the week?
It was interesting to have conversations with the investors here. Of course, inflation is a big one. Big debate still going on, whether it's transitory or whether it's just a permanent thing, we'll see. Supply chains being mentioned as well. Bitcoin and cryptos, a big topic as well, because for me, it goes hand in hand and seems to be going hand in hand for the investors as well. Although we've been hearing statements from some of the keynote speakers as well, that some of the crypto money is now flowing into gold as well, just to have some more stability, less volatility. It's just safe haven investing, more or less, because Bitcoin, as you know, it's limited. It's only 21 million Bitcoins in circulation in theory, or it should be in circulation at the end. And that's more volatile. Obviously, you have 10, 15% moves, while gold moves 2%, which is still a lot, but in gold terms, it's okay. Basel III, we've been hearing questions about that. I'm not an expert on it, but it was interesting to hear investors ask our panelists as well, what do they think? So that's something people have in mind as well.